This audio presentation is brought to you by imaginationandfaith.com. To download tons of free books, audiobooks and audio lectures by Neville Goddard, please visit our website at www.imaginationandfaith.com.
For there is only one Creator in the world. By Him all things were made, and without Him was not anything made that was made. For doth evil befall a city, unless the Lord has done it? And then we see 200,000 Pakistanians in a matter of hours wiped out by a typhoon, followed by the usual tidal wave. And we wonder why the Lord did it. But who is the Lord? If you study the scriptures carefully, you'll find out who did it. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood. And the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelled within us. Aren't you wearing a robe dipped in blood? That is the robe. This garment of flesh is the robe that the Word of God wears. And the Word of God is God. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So the Word spoken of in Scripture is seated right here in a garment dipped in blood. And that being seated here is your own wonderful human imagination. God and man are inseparable because God in man and exists in us and we in him. The eternal body of man is the human imagination. That is God himself. So whether it be the typhoon that wipes out 200,000 in a matter of hours, or the long weekend that took almost 700 lives in our country, in this wonderful weekend where it is all thanksgiving and all a joyful state, it is still done by the Lord. So when Amos asked the question, he answered it. Does evil befall a city unless it has been done by the Lord? Well, one must know who the Lord is. And the Lord is our own wonderful human imagination. Therefore, you and I have the identical talent. You want to call God a talent. But not all of us trust him. Not all of us cultivate him. The identical God, for God is one, and his name is one. But do I trust the Lord? Do I cultivate the Lord? All we have to do, really, if I really accept the Lord as my own wonderful human imagination, is to work it up, work up my own imagination, to the state of vision. And then the thing is done. You mean it comes out that very moment before me? Not necessarily. It could. But the vision has its own appointed hour. It ripens. It will flower. If it seems to us long, wait. For it is sure, and it will not be late. You take any state in this world, and in your imagination, you work it out. And I tell you, from my own experience, you can see it. It becomes almost an objective reality in your mind's eye. Others don't see it. Doesn't really matter. You see it in your mind's eye, and it seems to you real. And it seems to you objective at that moment. And you drop it, in confidence that that vision has its own appointed hour. And it will ripen, and it will flower. And if to others that you might have mentioned it seems long, then wait. It is sure and it will not be late. You will not bring it in one moment before time, and you will not delay any more than you, the Word of God, will actually experience God until that appointed hour. So he said, I am the truth. All right, I am the truth. In the meanwhile, I am steeped in error, believing everything but in my own wonderful human imagination. I believe in that one, I believe in that one, I believe in this person, I believe in all kinds of things other than my own imagination. And so what I do, I am steeped in error. But at the appointed hour, I will experience the truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So no matter how long I have been steeped in error, at the appointed hour, I will experience the truth of Scripture. Then at that moment, I am completely set free of all the things I formerly believed in. Now I know who I am. I know exactly what I am and who I am, because I have experienced the truth. And you shall know, which is, you will experience the truth, and the truth will set you free. So let them all be as they are. I pray not only for these, said he, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. So I'll pray for them, yes, all those who hear me. But I'll pray not only for these, but for those who will actually believe in me through their word. For I'll be gone, and they will tell it, for they will have experienced what I am talking about. And then when they actually hear it, you will gather one by one, and all become once more the one body, the one spirit, the one Lord, the one God and Father of all. So I pray not only for you who come, but for those who will come after I am gone, who will believe in me, that is the story, through your word, you having received it, having experienced it. And so the question is, does evil befall a city unless the Lord has done it? He did not only allow it, he did it. Well, who was that Lord? The one who is clothed in a robe dipped in blood. That's the Lord. Well, who is that Lord? Well, I am. I certainly wear a robe that is dipped in blood. Cut it and you will see there is blood there. And this is the robe that I wear. And this is the word speaking to you that is actually now clothed in a body that is flesh, and the Word became flesh and dwelt within us. So as you go out, believe it. Your own wonderful human imagination is the only God of the universe. There is no other God. There is no other power. Nothing outside of your own wonderful human imagination. To what extent will you accept Him? Will you accept Him unconditioned? You may accept Him, well, with a little bit of this added to it. But the day will come, you will actually have Him and have Him alone. And nothing but God. You're either with me or against me, said He. You can take a little bit of me, but if you feel I will take a little bit while, and then eventually grow into the wholeness of it, all well and good. But the day will come, you will only accept the Lord. And the Lord you will discover to be your own wonderful human imagination. That is God. So, man is God. And God is man. And they are inseparable. God of prayers, said Blake, and God is light to those poor souls who live and dwell in night. But does the human form display those who dwell in realms of day? For you meet man, you aren't going to see God in any more glorious form than you see Him as man. His face is man. His hands are man. It's man. Don't go beyond it. The face, the voice, the hand, that's man. And that's the glory of God. And God is man. So whatever you do to man, you're doing to God. And whatever befalls man, it is God who is doing it, because not a thing could happen to that man unless that man, in exercising the power of the universe, did it to himself. My body is an emotional filter, and I bear the marks of my prevalent emotions, good, bad, or indifferent. So you hear something concerning a man called Neville, and you will say, well, he should have known better. Well, no question I should have known better. But nothing can happen to me if I had not done it. Can evil befall the city? Well, this else is the city. Can evil befall this thing called Neville unless the look has done it? It cannot be. It cannot be. Therefore, anything that befalls me, I did it unto myself. No man comes unto me unless my Father draws him. I and my Father are one. So he cannot do anything to me unless I first did it to myself. And in my sleep and in my ignorance, I didn't know it. And I thought I was doing it to another. And in my strange sleep, I imagined unlovely things of another. And maybe even wished them and hoped for them. And set them all in motion. And then came the appointed hour. And because there is no other, at that moment of the appointed hour, when it must ripen, it flowers then in me. And I bear the fruit of it. This is life. What you say about a little child, there's no such thing as a little child. We are coexistent with God. There is not such a thing as a beginning of a little child. It was before that the world was. It came down into the world and clothed itself in a garment of flesh. Just as you and I did. And we seem today more mature because we are now in our 60s. And the little child just started. He seems to just start. He didn't begin in his mother's womb and he doesn't end in the grave. He was before that the world was. There never was a time when he was not. And nor shall there come a time when he shall cease to be. Beginning and end of a dream. Just dream. We are all one glorious be all one. Now tonight, if you really accept what I'm trying to get over and dwell upon how he is clothed, it will make it easier for you to accept him if you know that he is clothed in a robe dipped in blood. Read it in the 19th chapter of the book of Revelation. He is clothed in a body, in a garment, dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. Well, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. By him all things were made, and without him was not anything made that was made. Not a thing. All right, he is the only creator. But now the Word, spoken out here, became flesh. Well, I am flesh. He became flesh and dwells, the Word translated among us, really meaning within. Take your concordance and look it up. The Word is within, not among. Although you could use it. For certainly he is still among us, but he is within us, and he is clothed in a garment that is dipped in blood. And what little child is not a garment of blood? That's where the Lord dwells. And that garment is a garment that the Lord wears. And he is using his imagination morning, noon, and night. And imagination is the Lord. For he dwells in me as my own wonderful human imagination. By that power I create whatever I create. By that power I injure or bless myself. By that power I injure or bless anything in my world. And it's only myself pushed out. Therefore, if I know this, it doesn't really matter where I start in life. If I start in a palace, I am no better off than if I start in the gutter, if I know who I am. For if I know who I am, and starting in the gutter, I can rise to any level that I want in this world, if I know who I am. for that is the only power in the world. I could start at the top, not knowing who I am, go all the way down into the gutter. As we told you this past week, here is a DuPont. You could think a DuPont could lose its money, and he dropped $31 million. And his friends are all wondering, how on earth could we get into this with a man whose grandfather, or great-great-grandfather, started the DuPont billion, and his present father is now the chairman of the board of that fabulous concern, and he loses $31 million, and now has declared himself a banker. So you can start there and go to the gutter, or you can start in the gutter, as the great-great-great-grandfather did, and rose to the top. If I know who I am, and so what who I am, but my being, I am, that's the name. When I say I am, where am I? I'm the Brahman. Well, that is the only Lord of the world. It's the only God of the world. Well, now, what do I want? Well, now, don't take anyone into my consideration. Just what do I want? Now, take my imagination and work it up to the state of vision. Well, how do I work it to the state of vision? Well, I take you. I take my wife. I take my child. I take my brother. And let them see me as they would have to see me if I were the man that now I am assuming that I am. And so I work it up to vision. And suddenly, in my mind's eye, they appear, and they have to see me as I am assuming that I am. And then I listen in on their conversation, which implies that they do see me. It is a fact. And when I am completely satisfied that they do see me as I am seeing myself, then I break it. I drop it, knowing that that vision has its own appointed hour. And it ripens and it will flower. And if, to me, who did it, it seems long, well then wait. For it is sure and it will not be late. It will come on time. Not before, and not late. It will be right on time. And suddenly the whole thing will appear in my world and they will see it. If I know that is how things are created in this world, does it really matter where I start? Can I not tell every child born of woman who they really are? And when I depart this world, still telling it because they are worlds within worlds within worlds. This is not ended when I depart this world. I woke yesterday morning, and a friend of mine has been gone now for about 6 years, a doctor, a very funny fellow. And I was with him about a month before he died, and he just simply went down to nothing in weight. And he said, but you know from experience that there is continuity, that there is survival. I don't know. I have no assurance. You're all right. My friend who drove me down to his home, almost down to the San Diego factory. He too was a doctor. And he said, now you don't know, but Neville knows. He claims he does, and I believe him. But I don't know. I have no assurance whatsoever. He was a doctor, but he really wanted to be a musician. He loved music beyond anything in this world. His house was just simply full of instruments. And that was his passion. Well, he has gone now 6 years. His wife remarried, and his two children, they're married. But he had a very peculiar, wonderful sense of humor. The first day I met him, years ago when I came out and I lived at what is now the, used to be the Tun House. It's now the church in the West or something. But he moved in and spent the month that I gave my lectures here for Fred Dale. And the very first day that I met him, he asked me to come to his suite of rooms. He said, you know, I feel more like I do now than when I came in. Well, now, that doesn't make sense, does it? I feel more like I do now than when I came in. And after he said it, because it didn't make sense, he said, now repeat what I said. Well, I couldn't. It made no sense. Well, he did the same thing yesterday morning. Not that line, just show me. Well, he died at the age of 56. I know you go back to around 20, and here he stands before me, and he didn't look one day over 25, 24. And he pulled not that same line, but something far more funny than that. And I woke laughing. I thought I'd disturb my wife laughing. I woke out actually not screaming, but laughing out loud. It was so altogether funny. And he took words and twisted them in the same way. And there he is, a man of about 24, 25. That was the way he would identify himself with me. Well, here I was in this place. It was a hospital. And I was talking with another doctor, and all of a sudden he comes in, and he pulls the line. I tell you, the whole vast thing is within man. There is no death. But man has to awaken to who he is. Now he knows that he has survived. He has no doubt in his mind's eye that he is restored to life. But he's just the same wonderful boy that he was here, 36,